Macmillan Audio presents Billionaire at the Barricades, The Populist Revolution from Reagan to Trump by Laura Ingraham. Read for you by the author.
Introduction. An early warning sign. If I had to pinpoint a single moment that foreshadowed the rise and ultimate victory of Donald Trump, I would choose June 10th, 2014. That was the day a little-known economics professor defeated the Republican House Majority Leader, Eric Cantor, in a primary challenge. It had never happened before in American history. Not a single member of the media or political establishment saw it coming. Yet Dave Bratt's victory didn't come out of nowhere. It was actually a logical outcome after years of Republican leadership that had grown smug, insulated, and totally out of touch with the concerns of its own grassroots. In early 2014, when filmmaker and Virginia native Ron Maxwell initially brought Dave Bratt to my attention, I was skeptical for the obvious reasons. I'd never heard of him and didn't know anyone who had. But Maxwell, a conservative populist, had done his homework and tilled the ground for several months before I ever entered the picture. Bratt appeared on my radio show several times over the last 4.5 months of the campaign. Although we had yet to meet in person, I found him to be humble, courageous, and smart. Meanwhile, Bratt was doing precisely what I had urged interested Americans to do 10 years earlier in my book, Power to the People. Get involved, run for office, and pursue policies that give power back to the people. In 2009, the Tea Party, the first authentically populist movement on the right in decades, emerged in response to Obama's reckless bailouts and gained strength after the passage of Obamacare. Although the Tea Party helped elect a number of people to Congress, it was still a minority within the GOP. Undaunted by the very imposing barricade of establishment money and power that lay before him, Bratt took his case directly to the people. Most aspiring politicians would have been scared off by Eric Cantor's staff of 23 or the $5.4 million he had to spend on advertising, but not Bratt. He had a team of two and had only raised $200,000. It was Dave versus Goliath. "They don't take me seriously," he told me a few months before the primary. "And right now, that's just the way I like it." His drive and determination were inspiring. Disorganized and small in representation, the Tea Party movement had wandered since the 2010 midterm elections, and Bratt's brainy fearlessness was exactly what it needed. Besides, I reasoned, how will we ever save America from a corrupt, unresponsive, ineffective federal government if we don't support those with real talent who are willing to stick their necks out and challenge the status quo? Even if Bratt could come within striking distance of Cantor, that could spur other independent, strong conservatives to challenge lame incumbents across the country. Such were my thoughts as I weighed whether to throw in with the underdog. On June 3rd, 2014, a Tuesday night, my producer Julia Hahn, another business associate, and I made the 2.5-hour drive from Washington to the leafy Virginia town of Glen Allen to support Dave Bratt. The Republican primary vote for Virginia's 7th congressional district was just a week away, but as we rolled up to the Dominion Club, none of us knew what to expect. Incredibly, not a single national Tea Party group had given Bratt any financial support, although the local Richmond Tea Party had endorsed him. The polls showed Cantor ahead by 25 to 30 points, and he was getting big money air cover in the form of ads from powerhouse lobbying groups like the American Chemistry Council, the Chamber of Commerce, and the National Association of Realtors. "Let's hope people actually show up tonight besides some snarky reporters," I told Julia, who personally took it upon herself to make my appearance happen. I wondered to myself whether the whole thing was a bridge too far, a total waste of time. We were doing the round trip in one day after my 3-hour radio show and an appearance on Fox and Friends. I should be home eating dinner with the kids, I thought. But then, as we approached the club's driveway, we saw the cars, hundreds of them, lined up, spilling out of the parking lots. The moment we walked into the lobby, I was overjoyed that we had made the effort. The Bratt Pack was out in full force. "Thank you for coming, Laura," chirped a 40-something woman standing in the hallway with her teenage daughter. "Dave Bratt's the man," someone else blurted out. Our boy's gonna win, exclaimed a man who introduced himself as just a plain old farmer. He had come at the last minute after hearing about the rally from his neighbor. A few were wearing can't stand canter buttons. Most were just neatly dressed, everyday middle-class Americans. We got him right where we want him, Brad insisted, in reference to the incumbent canter, at what was our first face-to-face meeting. I laughed and wondered if I would be as optimistic were I in his shoes. Tan, with his sandy brown hair combed back and wire-rimmed glasses, Brad had the look of an all-American prepster. His smile was real and reassuring. More than the average politician, Brad understood the urgent need to disrupt the old GOP hierarchy. Fundamental conservative change would not be possible in Washington unless and until the establishment in both parties was exposed and defeated. For decades on key issues, they had been in an alliance of convenience, working against the interests of everyday Americans. On no issue was this collusion more apparent than immigration reform, aka amnesty. Over the years, I've developed a pretty accurate rule of thumb for judging the conservatism of Republican politicians. If they refuse multiple requests to appear on my radio show, they're usually up to no good. Case in point, Eric Cantor. Majority Leader Cantor had turned down several invitations from my bookers to join us on the air to discuss his 2013 legislation, misleadingly known as the Kids Act. It was essentially his version of President Obama's Dream Act and would have given a path to legalization to illegal immigrants brought here as children. Cantor thought he could dodge the tough questions by simply avoiding them. That told me a lot. Apparently, it was that same aloof, I don't need to answer to anyone attitude that rubbed the voters of the 7th Congressional District the wrong way as well. In the final week before the June 10th primary, we covered the race every day on radio. I begged Glenn Beck to get involved, and to his credit, he did, by interviewing Brat on his popular radio show. Radio host Mark Levin had been in the pro-Brat camp for some time and was also extremely influential. Likewise, the populist website Breitbart played a critical role in this historic primary by covering the race and the issues motivating Brat's challenge. As for the rest of the media, many of the same people and institutions that look down on talk radio and conservative websites, they barely touched on the race at all. On June 10th, after my radio show wrapped up at noon, I said a silent prayer for a surprise Brat victory. If he could pull off this sneak attack against Cantor and the big corporatist forces that backed him, anything was possible. None of my staff would take bets on the outcome. We were all too nervous. Later that night, I was celebrating my son Dimitri's 6th birthday at a home of a close family friend. Through dinner and cake, I didn't have my cell phone handy. I was so focused on his big day, I had put Brat's big night out of my mind. Their home telephone rang. It was one of my friends, a Brat supporter. "Where have you been? We've been trying to reach you. He won! He won! Dave won!" "Yes!" I screamed, with a mouthful of frosting still sitting at the dining room table. Those gathered must have thought I had hit the lottery. I ran for the phone where the texts and emails were pouring in. Not long after, I was on Fox News' special coverage of the Cantor loss. "He really just didn't have very much money, but what he did have was a lot of heart," I said of Brat in a telephone interview with Megyn Kelly. I think there will be a lot of people out there saying this could be the beginning of something really big for the Republican Party. Fox News political analyst Britt Hume disagreed, and he was not alone among conservative commentators in expressing dismay over Brat's massive upset of the GOP old guard. Hume said, "The margin is amazing. The conventional wisdom on this, that this is bad news long-term for the Republicans and great news for the Democrats. It is argued by some that immigration reform now will never pass with Republicans who were very much chastened by what happened to Eric Cantor. So that's dead for now. That means the Republicans will go forward into the 2016 election without their name associated with immigration reform, which will make it very difficult for any Republican to become president." Or so he thought. Every news outlet in America reported on Brat's unprecedented victory. "One of the most stunning primary election upsets in congressional history," wrote the New York Times. "The loss wasn't just big, it was historic," said NBC News. The Washington Post called it a historic electoral surprise that left the GOP in chaos. As for Cantor himself, he had little to say on election night except that he came up short. According to the Washington Post, he was so confident on election day that he was hanging out with lobbyists at a Starbucks on Capitol Hill. When approached leaving a D.C. Italian restaurant the night his heir apparent crashed and burned, Speaker John Boehner had no comment. Other GOP bigwigs seemed intent on spinning the Dave Brat victory as a one-off. The party's 2012 presidential nominee Mitt Romney dismissed the notion that the Cantor defeat was a harbinger of change to come in the GOP. "I know it's our inclination to look at races and suggest that somehow a national movement is causing what occurs," he told NBC's David Gregory. When asked specifically whether a rising conservative populism was in the air, Romney batted away the suggestion, noting that the Republican Senator Lindsey Graham, disliked intensely by the Tea Party, easily won his primary challenge in South Carolina. To his credit, he did cite the frustration of voters on the immigration issue as a driving force in the race. Contrary to what many pundits and Wall Street Journal Republicans claimed in the aftermath, Cantor's support for immigration amnesty was a major factor in his loss. Brat pounded that theme relentlessly, along with Cantor's cozy relationship with K Street and his overall disregard of the concerns of his constituents. The six-term congressman had become everything that the Tea Party and other grassroots conservatives hated about the GOP. The Sunday after the primary, I was part of the ABC panel that discussed the Cantor primary loss. Eric Cantor was on the panel before us. Saying little of interest, he didn't seem to fathom why he lost. Zero insights. When his segment was over, he exited the studio out of a side door to avoid crossing paths with me. Ron Maxwell posited, "Objectively thinking, I really believe it was the beginning of everything that followed and led directly to Donald Trump." Although Tea Party groups launched other primary challenges against establishment GOP candidates in 2014 and weren't successful, it didn't matter. Brat's win was cataclysmic and gave encouragement to conservative populist activists coast to coast. For the first time, they had proof positive that the establishment doesn't always win. 1 year later, Donald Trump crashed the Republican Party when he announced his presidential bid. Even Cantor's defeat hadn't prepared the establishment for the possibility that their grip on the GOP was weakening. Yet given the voters' building discontent with Republican politics as usual, they should have seen Trump coming. His populist counterinsurgency campaign was brash and bold, and entirely predictable after years of failed GOP and Democrat efforts to grow our economy and put America on the right track. If the people were mad enough to oust a sitting majority leader, anything was possible. The populist movement made it possible. The force behind Dave Brat's victory was populism, the belief that people should have power instead of ceding it to the elites. Americans are used to left versus right political disagreements, like judicial activism versus judicial restraint, union versus non-union. Populists understand that there's a top and a bottom, too. The establishment, composed of powerful elites on both the left and the right, does not trust individuals to make decisions for themselves. Instead, they believe Washington experts and bureaucrats must fill the void. Populists believe individuals should have more control over their own lives. Presidential candidates invoke the populist style because it connects with the working people. Except for Reagan, all modern presidents of both parties campaigned as populists, but governed as globalists. Populism isn't new. It arose in the 1890s when the so-called robber barons, businessmen, who gained wealth and influence through unethical business practices, amassed power that hurt workers. Populists revolted and formed a short-lived National People's Party. Its platform was essentially left-wing. It was pro-labor and anti-capitalist and was especially hostile to banks and railroads. That party effectively merged with the Democrats in 1896 and ultimately disappeared in 1908. But the populist style, with its emphasis on the common sense wisdom of the working class, remained a potent force that Democrats and Republicans both co-opted for years to come. Because populism isn't an ideology, it often appears with a descriptor like progressive populism or conservative populism. On the left side of the political spectrum, progressive populism wraps big government schemes in the guise of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.